In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe. The Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
and He's given us new life.
We believe in the crucifixion.
Good morning and welcome to Mount Pleasant United Methodist Church and our weekend worship experience. We're so excited that you're with us today. You know, I counted and found that this is going to be our 13th online worship experience. You know, as a church, we have not closed our doors. We've simply adapted to a new reality. We've found new creative ways to reach out with the good news of who Jesus is, to use new technologies in ways that are spanning the globe. We're now finding new people that we met when we were on our trip to the Holy Land that are connecting with us now online. And so we're so excited that you are checking out this online worship experience and pray that our time together will be a blessing to you. You know, the Bible tells us that when we come into a moment of worship, we need to come humbly, we need to come reverently, and we need to come honestly. We gather here because we need to be in God's presence. We need to reconnect with that spiritual side of who we are. We need to experience what God has in store for us. We need to come as we are, right where we are. But we also have to realize that God will meet us right where we are, but not where we pretend to be. So I pray that in our time together, you will find that connection. You will find that honesty. You will find that presence of God's Spirit speaking to you, drawing you away from where you are into a deeper relationship with Him and His church. And so we invite you to become part of all the good things that are happening here at Mount Pleasant and invite you to get in touch with us. Fill out a connection card that you'll find online on the church's website, and we'll get in touch with you and invite you into a bigger story, invite you to what God is really doing globally as well as in our own families. So friends, I want to say welcome on behalf of the church. My name is Steve Gidon, and I get to serve here, and I want to connect with you and get to know you personally. So friends, welcome to worship.
Good morning. I'm Kristen Parrish.
And I'm Whit Parrish.
And we want to welcome you to our online worship experience with Mount Pleasant this morning. If there's one thing that we're learning as a result of this social distancing, it's that our faith and our mission is so much bigger than a building can contain. We're learning to adapt to a whole new world, finding new ways to worship and new ways to serve a broken world. We're glad that you're with us today. Let us join together for our responsive call to worship.
Mount Pleasant people, raise up your voices in response to God's goodness.
We praise you, O Lord, for all the blessings you have given us.
Mount Pleasant people, lift your hearts in sweet surrender to God's mercy.
We thank you, O Lord, for hearing the prayers of our hearts.
Mount Pleasant people, pray for the redemption and renewal of God's people.
The love and mercy of God never fails. Amen.
Come, my friends, let the power of the Holy Spirit overshadow you. Let the light of Christ dwell within you, and let the majesty of God the Father transform you into people of a higher purpose. God does all this for us because God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good. Today we invite you to join us in our opening prayer. Prayer invites us to set aside our agenda and open our heart to God's peace. It's a moment of personal intimacy, the kind that exists between a loving parent and a rambunctious child. God knows the secret of our hearts even before we ask, but loves that we have come to ask and seek. You will see a list of names of people that we are praying for on your screen. If you have a special prayer concern and would like us to pray for you, please contact us. We will be happy to pray for you too. We will conclude with the Lord's Prayer, which will be posted on the screen. If this is your first time praying, simply bow your head, take a deep cleansing breath, and feel God's presence rest upon you. Let us pray.
Mighty God, everything you do reveals your glory and majesty and points to a better life. How many times have we failed to see? How many times have we not heard your voice? How many times have we not felt your presence? We cannot begin to comprehend the number of blessings you have in store for those you love. As we gather today, we pray that you would change our hearts, our minds, and our souls with your Spirit. Transform us, O Lord, and make us more like you. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us with the fire again that we might light your way for those in darkness. Give us joyful hearts, powerful voices, and bold dreams that we can do together. Come, Holy Spirit of the loving God, into our worship, animate our praise, energize our music and our songs, and inspire our hearts in prayer. Hear our prayers for those you have named before you who are on our hearts this morning. Help us serve them and all your children everywhere who cry out to you and long to be comforted. This we pray in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, good morning, kids. It is good to see you again this morning. I hope that you've had a fantastic week. I've been looking forward to getting together with you again this morning. And I want to say hi to all of my friends that are out there. I want to say hi to Hunter and Natalie. I want to say hi to Lennon and Olive. I want to say hi to Elias and Jonah, to Elsie. I want to say hi to Aiden and to Adley and to Adoniah and to Aspen. I want to say hi to all of my friends that are here. I want to say hi to Eli and to Jason and to Joyce. I want to say hi to Kevin and to Kaylin. I want to say hi to Calvin and to Leah. I want to say hi to all of my friends that are here joining us across this new technology to say hi and good morning to you. So let's celebrate. Let's get started with a bang. I love these things. I can't get enough of them. But I'm so excited to join you because we have some great things that we're going to be doing this morning. So tell me, I'm so excited that you've sent me your pictures of all of you that are planting something, that are getting started. I want to show you my plants. My wildflowers are beginning to really take off. They're growing. Maybe I need to thin them out a little bit to give them some more room, some more elbow room as they grow. My forget-me-nots are struggling, but they're coming along. They haven't given up. They're still growing. They're still prospering, just like all of us. So continue to send me your pictures. Continue to send me your exciting things that you're doing together as we grow, because we can always be adding beauty and wonders and helping God's kingdom, God's world, become a more beautiful place. Well, friends, today I brought something with me. I brought a bowl of apples. How many of you like apples? I love apples. They make wonderful, to just eat them like this. Sometimes they're made into pies or into cobbler, or I love applesauce. Lynette does a really good job with applesauce. So I got different kinds here. I got red ones, I got green ones, and I got some that are kind of in between. Which ones do you like best? Does it really matter to you? Well, I sometimes do, and sometimes I like different kinds, but sometimes I really like it when I peel the cover off of them and get right down to the core. Now, let me ask you, I got a question for you. Which apple did these pieces of fruit come from? They came from one like this. Which one do you think it came from? You know, it's really hard to tell, isn't it? Once you take that cover off, they're really all the same underneath. And you know, God told us a special lesson. In 1 Samuel chapter 12, the prophet Samuel is speaking for God, and he said, listen, people, he said, don't look at just the appearance. Don't just look at what's on the outside. He said, look at what is on the inside. The Lord looks at what's on the inside, the fruit, the quality of the fruit. He said, so often we just want to look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at what's in your heart. And so, friends, we worry more about what's in our heart than what's on our outward appearance. You know, God made all kinds of apples, and they're all delicious, but it's about what's on the inside that counts. Well, friends, today we're going to be talking about how important it is to focus on what's in somebody's heart and not just what you see on the outside. And so I hope that when you go home, when you're with your family, you focus on what is in somebody's heart, not just what they're doing on the outside. I've got a bunch of Tootsie Rolls that are just looking for a home. They're looking for you to come and share them with all of our friends and love one another as God loved us. Well, friends, we're excited to get back together again, and I hope that we'll see you again real soon. Until then, remember, God loves you, and so do I. Until next time, God bless.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Romans, chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. By entering through faith into what God has always wanted to do for us, set us right with Him, make us fit for Him, we have it all together with God because of our Master Jesus. And that's not all. We throw open our doors to God and discover at the same moment that He has already thrown open His door to us. We find ourselves standing where we always hoped we might stand, and out in the wide open spaces of God's grace and glory, standing tall and shouting our praise. There's more to come. We continue to shout our praise even when we're hemmed in with troubles, because we know how troubles can develop passionate patience in us, and how that patience in turn forges the tempered steel of virtue, keeping us alert for whatever God will do next. In alert expectancy such as this, we're never left feeling shortchanged. Quite the contrary, we can't round up enough containers to hold everything God has generously poured into our lives through the Holy Spirit. Christ arrives right on time to make this happen. He didn't and doesn't wait for us to get ready. He presented Himself for this sacrificial death when we were too far weak and rebellious to do anything to get ourselves ready. And even if we hadn't been so weak, we wouldn't have known what to do anyway. We can understand someone dying for a person worth dying for, and we can understand how someone good and noble could inspire us to do to selfless sacrifice. But God put His love on the line for us by offering His Son in sacrificial death while we were of no use whatever to Him.
Throughout the ages, people of faith have returned time and time again to those core beliefs and those values that define who we are both as a church, but as Christians as well, called by God to go out and to make disciples of all people. Let us now join together as we share the historic affirmation of our faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As part of our worship time, we take a moment to reflect on all of the ways that we have been blessed this week. We focus on gratitude for all that God is doing in our lives, to reflect and to share joyfully in the mission and the ministry of the church. Let us now continue to give thanks by the giving of our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
I found my rest without you. When temptation comes my way, if when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. If when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
As we share joyfully all that God has given to us, we share now a good word, a blessing upon this church, upon these gifts, to praise God for everything that we have been given. Will you join with me in the doxology? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God, you heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Needs forgiveness.
I wanted to start this morning by asking you a rather simple question, I guess. What comes to your mind when you think of Mount Pleasant? What memories come back to you? What people's faces, what words, what thoughts, what prayers come to you when you think of Mount Pleasant and our call to ministry? Well, I've had that chance to think about those over the last several days and weeks now, a lot more than I have in the past, primarily because there's nobody else here. What does it mean to be in ministry when we're in quarantine and we're in isolation? And as I've thought about those, I've always come to one solid, indisputable, and inescapable conclusion. And that is that God isn't done with us yet. Surprised? That's about as good as it gets. Maybe you were thinking that I had something like, when is the second coming? Or what stocks should we be picking? But I don't. I'm just like you. I'm learning, changing, growing, stretching. I'm curious, I'm cautious, and most of the time I'm just confused. But I know that God isn't done with us yet, and that means a lot. There's one more thing. You know who doesn't like change? Everyone. And isn't that kind of a strange thing if you think about it? Here we have this church, we have all these people that are trying desperately to avoid change. And you know, who was the biggest change maker? Jesus. The one that we follow. His methods of disruptive change, of changing people's lives, of lifting them out of the muck and the mire, out of the boredom and the routines, and giving them a fresh glimpse of what life could be. And so here we are, resistant, hesitant, scared, cautious. And there's Jesus, leading, hopeful, optimistic, radical. As we continue to grow through these next couple of weeks, as we continue to discover all that is possible, what we're really about, what's happening to us is we're changing on the inside. We're coming to a new understanding of who we are and especially who we can become. We are the change agents. As a church, that's what we're called to do. We're called to bring change to the world. We are the light of the world. We are the salt. We are a beacon on the hill. We are called to be change agents. And so what that means is for you and me individually, we have to embrace change. We have to recognize it. We have to understand that God isn't done with us yet, that there's still more to come. There's still more to grow. And so I think about change, not just from my perspective, but from God's perspective. I think about this church because I recognize that so often my perspective is skewed, right? Oftentimes we want our own comforts, our own convenience. It's kind of natural. And sometimes we need somebody to help kind of, you know, prod us along a little bit to get a fresh perspective. Sometimes we need our friends to be downright confrontational. Sometimes we need comfort, but oftentimes we need a challenge. You know, I hope that when you think about your relationship with church, it isn't just a Sunday morning routine. It's something that draws the best out of you, that helps you to see life as it could be and still might be if we had the courage to go there together, to be stronger together. About reaching for our ideal reality. I know that there's a lot of people that are out there that are cynical, they're critics, and they just want to be consultants of the way life ought to be. They're critical of life, of church, and certainly the church has stumbled over the last couple hundred years. But not because our values are wrong, but because we struggle to interpret what that means to follow Jesus every day. But here's the good news. The good news is our values are still solid. Sometimes we stumble along the way. And of course, there are people that are quick to pick up on our imperfections. They're quick to notice where we stumble. They're quick to notice where we've failed to measure up. And we have to take ownership of that. But here's the good news. We are moving. We're pushing the boundaries. As long as we continue to climb higher, there will always be slips and starts. But the vision never ceases. We're still called by God to something more. Do we stumble? Absolutely. Will we stumble in the future? Sure. But we'll keep pick ourselves up, we'll learn, and we'll move forward. Somebody once said that Christianity is at its best when it makes us ask hard questions of ourselves. And then it guides us to do what is right, not just what is easy. And it inspires us to do what others say can't be done, to discover that better part of ourselves. When I think of Mount Pleasant, that's what I think of. A place that calls us to a higher place, to a better vision of what we can be. And that's what I want to do with you in our time together today. I've also read that sometimes the church is at its worst when it deludes us into thinking that we have all of the answers for everybody else, and that we arrogantly feel that it's our responsibility to tell them where they're wrong. I hope that this morning when you come for worship, you came with a sense of humility, that it's time for change. It's time to grow. It's time to expand. It's time to be challenged. I hope that you're ready to go to that next level, to dig deeper and to experience. I want us to start by just asking you a simple question. When was the last time you went deeper? That you picked up that ancient text, that life book that we call Scripture, and you begin to discover what Jesus really said about who we are and who we can become. I've noticed over in the last couple of weeks, the world seems to be exploding, not only with the virus, but with this evil that has been permeating our culture and our society for the last couple hundred years, called racism. Now, the interesting thing that I want to talk about that is anybody that does just a cursory view of the Scriptures understands that if anybody could bring people together, it should be the church, right? If anything that we stand for in life, it's bringing people together. That's what Jesus was really all about. Jesus got in people's face by having meals with tax collectors. Gentiles, can you imagine? Gentiles, Samaritans. Remember that Gentiles and Samaritans were the people from the other side of the tracks. For those of you that live in southern West Virginia, you know about the coal fields, you know about the train tracks, people that lived on the other side of the tracks. They were the dividing line. Well, Jesus had no respect of those boundaries whatsoever. We are that living legacy. If there's anybody that should stand against racism, it is the church. It is us. We are the beneficiaries of that legacy. And yes, the church has not always stood toe-to-toe against evil in our world. Sometimes we have stumbled, absolutely. But those values, those principles remain strong, remain at our core, and always, always bring us back to where we need to be. And so this morning, as we think about the evil that is permeating our society, it is time for the church to stand up, to speak loud, to be a leading voice of change in our world. We need to stand against evil. That's what we do. We are the light in the darkness. And against that light, the darkness has not understood it and cannot overcome it. What we need to do as the church is to make that light burn all the brighter. So how do we recognize evil? Let's go all the way back to its very core. What is the essence of evil? What is its purpose? Why does it exist? Well, first of all, I want you to understand that God is unity. God is Trinity. God is relationship. God is love, as it says in 1 John. And so evil is the antithesis of that relationship. How do you recognize evil? Evil is divisive. Evil is destructive. Evil is demeaning to people's character and to their core soul. Evil tends to separate. It tends to isolate. And so wherever you find evil, You're going to find prejudice. You're going to find fear. You're going to find bigotry. Whether it's about race or whether it's about nationality, evil seeps in and deludes people into thinking that they are the ones that God prefers above all else. And yet, we're all part of God's family. We're all His children. Evil tends to twist our thinking. It tends to twist our perspective. It changes us. And so when Adam and Eve took that first bite of the apple, it twisted their mentality. They no longer saw each other the same anymore, and they no longer saw God the same. And they had to hide away in fear. Evil comes, and it comes in a very subtle way to all of us, pretending that we have no problems whatsoever, and it's always somewhere else for someone else. Evil plots us against them and introduces a sense of tribalism. The ones with the most power. You've heard that old saying, the golden rule. The one with the most gold makes the rules. That wasn't the way that God intended. That's not the way our faith believes that life should be. That's not what we want for our family and our kids. And so what is it that Mount Pleasant is known for? Are they known for our strength of our values and our convictions? And despite this whole pandemic, we have not closed, we have not stopped the fight, we have not gone silent. In fact, we are reaching more people now than ever before. Now, because of this new medium, our message is going global. That couldn't happen before. Now we're becoming more creative, more innovative. Now we're stretching and doing more and reaching more. And because of you and your help, our message and our faith is beginning to push back against the darkness. I can't help but wonder if Satan thought that he had kind of won, right? You know, the people aren't in church. They don't have to show up anymore. We've closed all of the churches. And yet there was always a remnant. There were always those that would fight the good fight, that would do whatever they could to push back against the evil. And so Jesus begins by inviting us to think differently about asking the hard questions about what we're supposed to be doing, where we are in the mission field that you've been planted. Each of you has a home, a place where you work, that you go. That's your mission field. That's the place that you are called to go out and to minister in that place, to bring your light into that dark world. So I wanted to share a couple of verses with you, if I could, to give you a glimpse into what Jesus is trying to draw out of us that maybe we don't see all the time. And maybe we just take it for granted. We just assume that our fellowship will always be strong, that we don't have any problems like the big cities, and yet we need to be a voice of reason, of faith, even here. Jesus is asking us to step up to the plate and to do more than we ever thought possible. And so wherever you are this morning, in the back of your mind, I pray that God stirs that gray matter, stirs you a little bit, makes your spine straighten up just a little bit more, and invite you to think deeply about who you are and who you can become. Are you ready to take on the fight that lies ahead? I wanted to share a couple of verses. One comes from John chapter 17, verse 22. Jesus said, he's talking to God. He says, "The glory that you gave me, I have given to them, so that they may be one even as we are one." You see, Jesus looks at the world and he sees the separation. He sees the isolation. There's Jew and Gentile. There's slave and free. There's male and female. And Jesus has a different vision of the kingdom. In the kingdom, Jesus is able to sit down with tax collectors. He's able to sit down with Samaritans. He's able to sit down with Gentiles. In that new kingdom that is coming upon us, Jesus is able to take the fractured world and draw it back together. Is change coming? You bet it is, in ways that we never thought possible. And we get to be at the forefront of it. We get to be at the leading edge so that at the end of our days, we'll be able to look back and say, I was there. I had a hand in bringing it all back together again. In Galatians chapter 3, Paul is writing. This is a famous passage. You know this one. In Christ there is neither Jew or Gentile, slave or free. There is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ. Unity. The Apostle Paul sees that what Jesus is doing is he's breaking down all of those barriers. He's breaking them down. The essence of our faith is that Christ died while we were yet sinners, while all of us were in rebellion, so that the family could come back together again and be whole. He has ransomed us from evil, from despair, from prejudice, from bigotry, from all of that, and brought us back together. You and I are in ministry of unity, bringing the church back together as one. In Colossians, Paul goes on. He's writing to the Colossians. Here there is no Jew or Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is in all and is in all. Because of what Christ is, because of the Spirit of God in me and in you, we are brothers and sisters in Christ. We are in faith. The same things that you would do with your biological family, you now have a responsibility to your spiritual family. Your spiritual family will long, long outlive your biological family. Did you ever think about that? We are one, for Jesus and the Spirit and the Father are one. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul writes, "For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body. Whether Jew or Gentile, slave or free, we were all given one Spirit to drink." And so what Paul is reminding us is because those barriers, because we are unified, we are stronger together. Imagine if we could take all of these people working for a common goal, working together as one, with one voice, with one purpose, with one vision, moving in one solid direction, believing at their very core that they were made for more than just sitting in a pew and paying their dues. That they believed in discipleship. They believed in imitating Jesus wherever they were. That they believed that there was more in them than just going through the motions and paying their bills. As you're watching this, I have to ask you, do you believe that Jesus has called you to more than just going through the motions, just waiting for the grave to claim you? As we respond, there is a natural reaction that when we believe, there's this welling up of energy, of enthusiasm, and people raising their hands and said, "You can count on me. Here I am, Lord. Send me. I'll go. Let me be a part of this transformational power that is sweeping the globe right now. I want to be a part of this church. I want to be a participant, a partner. I don't want to be just somebody sitting on the sidelines watching. I want to be an active role. I don't want to be just a consumer. I want to be a contributor. I want to roll up my sleeves and get messy. And in the process, feel a joy overwhelming you that you have been a part. And hear those words, well done, good and faithful servant." Are you ready to make that transformation? See, when people see us, they see Jesus. So what do they see when they see Mount Pleasant? What do they see when they see you? Do we take our light and do we hide it under a bushel? Do we pretend that we're not really involved in those events? This past week, the past 2 weeks actually, the country has been wrestling in a powerful way with the ongoing dilemma of racism, this evil that we just don't seem to have the strength to get over. The ability to believe that God has more, we have more churches in this country than you can shake a stick at. So why is it that the people that stand for unity, that believe that change is possible, that God is bringing on us a new kingdom, have such a hard time with this pervasive disease that we call racism? I believe sometimes we just don't want to pay attention. We just don't want to look at ourselves in the mirror. And that's why Christianity is so powerful. It forces you to look at yourself in the mirror. It forces you to come to the altar and confess your sins, sins of omission, sins of commission, sins of denial, sins of despair. I believe that God has got a great future for all of us, that our best is yet to come, but only if we're willing to roll up our sleeves and do what must be done. Jesus points the way. He's willing to lead us. He's willing to offer if we can partner together in order to bring about a change for all of God's children. Throughout the New Testament, there are times where Jesus has these wonderful connections with Samaritans, right? He goes to Jacob's well, very famous story of Jesus and the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well, and he encounters her and he has this dialogue. The interesting thing about that story is it involves not only a Samaritan, which is a different culture and a different race, a Gentile nation, completely separate, but it's also a female. And Jesus is breaking down those barriers. He's showing us what our lives can be. Now, we know Samaritans. We think, if I ever saw a Samaritan, you bet I'd help them. But the Samaritans are those people that are living around you all the time. They're the Samaritans that you turn a blind eye to when going into Walmart. They're the people that you whisper about in the quiet places of your own homes or your own heart. We think it's so easy for Jesus to go to a Samaritan. We certainly would do if we ever knew where Samaritans were, but we will not do it for those people that look different, that maybe talk different or act different, that we're afraid of. And so Jesus is inviting all of us to think differently. You're well aware of the story of the Good Samaritan. A man was hurt and the Levi went by, the priest went by, and they were just too busy. But the Samaritan's heart reached out, and it shocked people to think Samaritans would do what they would not. You see, Jesus is reminding us that we cannot reach our full potential. None of us can be our full potential to experience the joy and the peace and the serenity that we all long for unless we all go together. We all go together or we don't go at all. We're always going to be struggling, going to be hindered from experience the depth of what we really could be as a church. I've always found that the best place to restore hope in all people is among friends. And when we come here on a Sunday morning, when I look around here and I can see your faces, because you all kind of sit in the same place if you didn't notice that already, and I see the smiles I see over here in this corner where you exchange the kids and the kids run around and they hug, and, you know, we miss that. And friends, I believe we'll get back there. I really do. I believe this is a time of refining and a time of perspective. And this is an unprecedented time for us to think about who we are, to be reflective about what our faith means in times like this. So there's a couple of things I believe that we can do right now, all of us, to be a stronger church, to be stronger together, to take that next bold step as a church, to stand against racism in whatever form it takes. There's the first thing that we need to do, and I know that this sounds simplistic, but we need to pray. And I don't mean just those simple prayers like, God, I hope you do something. I mean the prayer of humility. The prayer of confession. You see, I don't believe that we can be angry with anybody if we're praying for them honestly, that we pray for their best, we pray for their welfare, we pray for the hurt that they've experienced. You know, for the last couple of weeks, you've seen probably on the news, certainly all of the demonstrations because of George Floyd's death. Tragic. And you've seen probably the other one of the man that was chased through Atlanta, right? Mahal Aubrey. And you've seen this rise of this movement that is coming forward called Black Lives Matter. Now, somebody has kind of pushed back against that, said, yes, but you know, all lives matter. Well, of course all lives matter. But right now there is a part of our home, our community, our friends that feel that they don't. And I don't know if that doesn't break your heart. Maybe it doesn't. Maybe God's got to do that. It isn't that they're saying that they're better or that you're not. It's just saying they're hurting and they feel like they don't matter to anybody. And so instead of saying, but I know that, but all lives matter, is not really saying anything at all. It's just saying you're kind of lacking a little compassion, aren't we? We don't feel. Friends, I hope that you can feel with empathy the hurt of our brothers and sisters when they feel that their lives just don't matter. And that's certainly not what Jesus stood for. While you and I, while we were Gentiles, while we were still sinners, he died for you and me. Do we not have the compassion to do that for somebody else? Will you pray for them? And I don't mean just going through the motions. I mean, come to worship. When we come to worship, we're asking God to change our hearts. God, let it begin with me. Is there any impure way? David, after committing adultery, in Psalm 51, he says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew the right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then he can go back and lead his people. Begin with you. What confessions do you need to make? Maybe it's because we've turned a blind eye for too long, and for that we must ask for forgiveness. Maybe we as a church haven't stood tall enough or strong enough against the evil that was slowly eating away at our soul. Maybe we as a church haven't elevated it as part of our vision for who we are as we go forward. We need prayer because prayer is humility before God. The second thing we need to do is we need education. We need to be students. Students of the things that we do not know. You see, arrogance simply means that I already have all of the answers and I don't need to learn anymore. I don't know if it's really arrogance or just stupidity. But either way, we all need to be students. That's what we are. We are students of the scriptures. We are students of humanity. We're students of one another. Now, we can go back to scriptures and say, yes, we should be students of the scriptures, and I agree. But I also think that there's an awful lot that we can learn from other people that are living real lives. And I wanted to give you a couple of opportunities to learn. The first one is I want you to look for a book called Just Mercy. I was given this for Christmas, not thinking that I would ever use it in a sermon. And it is a wonderful book. It's heartbreaking, but it's true. And we are all about truth and mercy and grace. If you haven't gotten a chance, there's also a movie about this. I haven't watched the movie, but I have read the book. I encourage you, pick up the book called Just Mercy. There's also another movie that I haven't had a chance to look at yet. It's called The 13th. It's on Netflix. Check it out. Learn what you can about the struggles of our African-American brothers and sisters, part of God's family, the Samaritans that are struggling to find identity and hope. We are the people that deal in hope. We are the place of second chances. We are the people that raise the banner and say, it will not happen here. Here, we are all one in Christ. And finally, and you'll probably be really surprised about this one, pick up the Book of Discipline. Yes, the Book of Discipline has a lot in about the social principles. How many of you knew that the United Methodist Church stands for social justice? We stand for equality. I want to read you a portion of this from the part on social community. It says, our respect for the inherent dignity of all people leads us to call for the recognition, the protection, the implementation of the principles of the Declaration of Human Rights so that the communities and the individuals may claim and enjoy their universal, indivisible, and inalienable rights. Inalienable rights. Have you ever heard of that before? We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal and they are endowed by their Creator to pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The Book of Discipline is a wonderful book of our values and our principles, our theologies, and who we are as people of God. Elie Wiesel, who struggled through the Second World War, through the Holocaust, wrote the following. He said, what hurts victims the most is not the cruelty of the oppressors, it is the silence of the bystanders. And so, friends, we can't be silent any longer. We can't pretend that it's somewhere else happening to someone else. We have to take a stand. We have to be educated. We have to understand what God is doing. But then above all, we have to have hope. And I don't mean just wishful thinking. We don't just have faith that God will take care of it. We have to have a faith that moves us to action, that causes us to respond, to get out and to march with people, to be vocal, to hold our public officials accountable, and to say the time has come for change because our brothers and sisters are hurting. They don't believe that they matter to anyone. And so, friends, I hope that you will stand to learn more, to become more involved, to say it's one of our core values that people will always be valued by God. And so, friends, I want to end with this. In a world that is torn apart by anger and hatred and conflict, we have both the privilege and the responsibility of being living signs of a love that will bridge all divisions and heal all wounds. That's the high calling of Mount Pleasant. That's your calling. For those of you that call Mount Pleasant home, that are members here with us, I wish right now we could just link arm in arm and say, it will not come here. We will stand against that kind of evil. And in our presence, that kind of evil cannot overcome us. We are one in Christ, one in ministry to all the world. And I pray that together, as we continue to grow, as we come out of this pandemic, we will be stronger, more unified, more mobilized than ever before. And so, friends, wherever you are, I pray that you feel God's presence in your life and that when you think about who are we, you will come to understand that you're the church that has a calling, a mission to transform the world. That we're not just going through the motions. We're not just showing up on Sundays. We're not putting our couple of bucks in the plate. We're world changers. We don't like change, but we're fighting against the powers that are. We're the risk takers. We're the change makers. We're the people that dispense hope when other people are ready to give up. Don't give up. Believe that Christ can still change this world and is in the process of changing us as we change the world in His name. Amen.
Risen from the dead, and He is Lord.
Well, friends, I want to thank you for joining us for worship today. I hope that you've been blessed either in the music or in the songs, in the prayers, or in the word. I pray that God has spoken to you about where you are, but especially about where you can be. I hope that this is just another step in your journey of faith, and that you'll continue through the rest of the week and through the rest of your life to reflect on all that has been happening here today. Although we've come to the end of our time together today, in a larger sense, it's the beginning of a new journey. A new chapter is beginning as you go out and live out this good news that God has for you. And so, friends, I pray right where you are that the love of God the Father, the grace of God the Son, and the fellowship of God the Holy Spirit will rest upon you, upon your family, upon your friends, and upon the journey of faith that begins with Jesus. Until next time, God bless.